Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'm going to open with a word of prayer, if that's okay with you all. Why don't you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we love you, and we thank you for the day. Heavenly Father, you have brought us for 28 years to this place. You have been with us, my Lord God, in the wilderness. You have been with us, my Lord God, in the garden, in the fertile place. You have been with us, Father, in the mountains and in the valleys. You have been with us, Lord Jesus. And we thank you. We thank you for your goodness, and we thank you for your faithfulness, for you are the faithful one. You are the faithful one inside everyone that's sitting in the house today. It's you. It's you, God, that wakes us up. It's you, God, that gives us the desire, that draws us into this house. It's you, God, that is all in all. So we acknowledge you. If this room was empty and if it was just us and you, my Lord God, your audience is worthy of acknowledgement and praise, of wonder, of majesty. You are the King of all kings. You are the God of all creation. And we bow before you in worship, Heavenly Father. We acknowledge this day as a special day. We acknowledge it, my Lord God. We mark the day. And we thank you for it and say you have brought us thus far, my Lord God. And we say this as a body, as a family, we say, continue to lead us. Lead us on, my Lord God, to the next and to the next and to the next. To all of the things that you still have in front of us. For you are the one who is with us now, and you are still the one who is to come. So we pray, God, guide us in every step that we take. It's in your name we pray, and we all say, amen, amen. God bless you all. Let's give the Lord a hand, everybody. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness and your goodness to us. Praise the Lord. Pastor, Dad, happy anniversary. Our founding father is with us. Amen. You and Mom, of course, we acknowledge you. Mom is with us also. She is in our hearts. She is the very fiber of this church and of our being. Amen. So happy anniversary, Dad. Happy anniversary, Pastor Phil. And, of course, to each and every one of you, happy anniversary. You know, this is exciting. I know that God is doing extraordinary things. I know that he coordinates everything, even the building, you know, the time. You know, I was talking with my brother this morning. Some of you may realize or may not realize that we moved into this building 10 years ago. And exactly 10 years ago on Easter is when we had our grand opening. So 10 years later on Easter, we're going to have our re-grand opening. Isn't that something? Yeah. And, you know, of course, with all of the other things going on, I hope you're excited and you maintain that excitement as you walk in and you see the construction process. You know, some of you like the construction process. Some of you say, like, well, when are you painting it? When are you putting the drapes on, you know? But I think most of us enjoy the process. And, you know, the turnout has been really, really extraordinary. Amen, brother? We've had 20, 30 out on a Saturday so far, and we get so much done. So enjoy the process, and we're going to talk about that until our opening day. Easter will be the opening day. We have still so much more to go. And if you look inside your bulletins today, of course, you know, with our bulletins, we're celebrating our anniversary, and we're going to have our business meeting today at 4, come back at 4 o'clock. We do that once a year. And then, of course, we have the other celebration. If you look inside your bulletins, you see the title of our conversation is Hidden Treasure. And I want to speak about that today concerning some of the other kings and leaders who have done remodeling on the churches or the houses of God in the past. So the title of our conversation, Hidden Treasure. If you remember the last time that we spoke, we talked about Hezekiah and his great reformation. Does anybody remember King Hezekiah and his great reformation, and he was zealous for the Lord, and he fixed up the temple of God. And it seemed like he was a good king, Scripture says, and he reigned for quite some time, maybe almost 40 years he reigned. And Hezekiah had a son, and his son's name was Manasseh. And you would think after Hezekiah's good and great reign, and he fixed the temple up and whatnot, you think, you know, we would just build on from there. But his son Manasseh was not such a good king. If any of you read Scripture says, as a matter of fact, Manasseh was an evil king. And you know what puzzles me? His reign was the longest reign of all of the kings of Judah and Israel. His reign was 55 years. You know, it's like, why did a good die young? He reigned for 55 years. Manasseh. And he did that what was not right in the eyes of the Lord. And after Hezekiah did his great reformation and fixed up the church, he brought in idolatry worship again into the temple. So much so that some theologians believe that the Ark of the Covenant, we have our symbol of it right here, the Ark of the Covenant was taken out of the temple by the priests to protect it from being defiled. So during the reign of Manasseh, the Ark of the Covenant was removed by the zealous ones for God so that that would not be polluted. And then when Manasseh finally died after 55 years of reign, his son came in his place, and his son's name was Amon. And it just so happens his son perhaps was more wicked than his father. And the people had enough. You might not like this story, but it's history. The people had enough with the wicked reign. Amon was king for 2 years. And the people said, we ain't doing this again. They conspired against him, and they killed him and dethroned him. And they said, enough is enough. The people had enough of this false worship, this pollution of the temple. And there was another son that rose up in his place. And that's the gentleman who I want to speak of today. And his name was Josiah. Godly King Josiah. By a show of hands, I'm curious. Has anyone ever heard of King Josiah? Everyone should raise their hand because I just mentioned his name. Yeah, I think I heard it from just like 10 seconds ago. King Josiah. Now, Amon didn't have a long reign, so King Josiah really didn't have a chance to grow up. He was 8 years old when they crowned him a king. 8 years old. Is anybody in the house 8 years old today? I'm curious. Anybody 8 years old? Oh, very good. God bless you. Josiah was 8 years old, and he became king over all of Judah. Amazing, huh? But Josiah, he did that which was right in the eyes of God. He was a good king, a godly king. And I think when he turned about 18, he finally said, enough is enough is enough. We're going to, guess what, brother? We're going to rebuild the temple. We're going to fix it up and tear out the rubble and cast out the idols. And we're going to restore the house of our God, King Josiah. So if you have your Bibles, let's just read this story about it. It's an interesting story. If you have your Bibles, why don't you turn to the 22nd chapter of 2 Kings. And let's read just a couple of verses and talk about King Josiah, the 8-year-old king. 8 years old. All right. And I have here, starting in verse 1, it says, Josiah was 8 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 31 years. So 31 and 8 is 39. At 39 years, he died, as a matter of fact, in battle. Verse 2 says, he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord and walked in all of the ways of his father David. Actually, David was his great-great-great-great-great-grandfather, but David was his forefather. And he did not turn to the right or to the left. He made no excuses. He was going to follow God. He said, if none will follow, I will follow. Right? But you're king, so you know folks are going to follow you, right? You got no choice. So he did not turn to the right, and he did not turn to the left. Verse 3 says, in the 18th year of his reign, King Josiah sent the scribe Shaphan to the temple of the Lord, and he said, go up to Hilkiah, the high priest, and have him get ready the money that was brought into the temple of the Lord, which the ushers have collected from the people. I changed some of those words to make it, you know, per our day. So we got the ushers involved. Liam, we in the house. Liam, there's an usher. Anthony, Nicholas, we had the ushers collect the offering for the rebuilding of the temple. Oh, that's good. So it goes on in verse 7. It says, let me come up a little bit. Verse 5. Have them entrusted to the men appointed to supervise the work of the church or the temple, and have these men pay the workers who repair the temple of the Lord, the carpenters, the builders, the masons, and have them purchase lumber and dressed stone to repair the temple. The money that was collected from the offerings that you put in the offering bag, the ushers collected it. It was used to pay the laborers. We paid some laborers as we built this house, right, brother? It was used to buy some supplies. We bought some lumber. We're getting ready to buy some more lumber because we gotta build this altar here. We're going to expand this altar. This altar is going to go out to that pillar, and it's going to go out to that pillar. It's going to be like, you know, maybe triple the size. So we got to go to the store and we got to go buy some wood. Yeah, right? There's nothing like all spiritual about that, right? Get in the truck, get the money, go buy the wood, and come back and build the altar. They did the same thing. He told the scribe, go get a hold of Hilkiah. He'll give you the money. Go to the store and get the lumber. I love it. So he did that. It says here, verse 7, it says, but they need not account for the money entrusted them because they are acting faithfully. You know, if we need to continually ask the folks in charge of us to give an account of the money that is spent, you know, why don't you get some new folks in charge of the money? All right? Because if you can't trust them, you need some new folks in charge of the money, you know? And this is scripture. They were faithful men entrusted to do the project and do the work of the Lord. And he said that they were faithful men. And in verse 8, it goes on to say, Hilkiah the high priest said to Shaphan the scribe, he said this, as they were doing their remodeling and their deconstruction and reconstruction, as they were tearing down the walls and clearing out the rubble of the temple, the high priest said, I found the book of the law in the temple and gave it to Shaphan, who read it. When they were tearing down, my brother and I were talking about this, when they were tearing down the walls, they found some stuff. You ever like go through your closets and do a spring cleaning or go through your clothes before laundry day and find some stuff? Yeah, you're looking for treasure, some of you. I know I got a dollar in my pocket somewhere. But you see, as they were cleaning out the temple, they found treasure. But the treasure that they found were the scrolls. Some say these were the scrolls that Moses himself wrote by his own hand. Some say they were a couple of the chapters of the book of Deuteronomy that had been maybe lost in the temple, perhaps maybe hidden in the temple, so that the holy thing would always be inside that temple. And as they did the reconstruction, they found this valuable treasure. They found the scrolls. So you see, the king sent forth the scribe and said, go collect the money so they can go get the wood and finish the building project. And as they did, Hilkiah said, wait a minute. As you're collecting all the money, and we do collect the money, and we do buy the wood, he says, but wait a minute, we found some real treasure, though. We found some real treasure. Before you leave with the dollars, don't forget the real treasure. And he said, we found the words of God. We found some scrolls. We found some scripture hidden in the walls or maybe beneath the foundation. We found some stuff. And this is what the king got excited about. He didn't get excited about the dollars. He got excited about the real treasure that they found in the temple. And he goes on and he says, it says that Shaphan the scribe went to the king and reported to him. He said, your officials have paid out the money that was in the temple of the Lord and have entrusted it to the workers and supervisors at the temple. Okay, we're building the project. Everything's going along just fine. But do not get confused and think that that is the main thing that's going on in this building. Do not think that the main thing is us tearing down these walls, us getting your dollars, going to the store, buying some wood. We're going to do it, but don't get distracted. That's not really what God is doing. There's something invisible going on here. There's something that's really going on inside of your life and my life and the world itself. Is anybody here today? Is anybody out there? All right, good. See, that's the real thing that's going on. Don't get confused. Don't get sidetracked. Like, we got to build this step. We got to build this wall. That's the wrong color over there. That don't get distracted. Amen. First of all, it's never the wrong color. I'm in charge of the colors. It's always just right. Anyway. But don't get distracted. There's something greater going on than you putting that wood there and you putting that nail there and you picking that up. There's something going on inside of my life and your life and our life. Amen. God will cause us to tear these walls down today and say, why don't you rebuild them tomorrow? Whatever it takes to get us to figure out what God's really doing in our lives, right? Amen. Yeah, are you excited? Amen. No, I just tore them down. I don't want to build them up again. No, I'm not excited, preacher. So he says, this is what we really found. And then in verse 10, it says, then Shaphan, the scribe, informed the king. He said, listen, Hilkiah, the high priest, he's given me a book. And Shaphan read it in the presence of the king. And when the king heard the words of the book of the law, scripture says that he tore his robes. And that's always an indication of something that goes on about the great reformations that Josiah had. And he tore down the idols, and he tore down the high places that the people were worshiping other than God himself. He tore his clothes and said, you know, God wants to do something new in your life. The tearing of the clothes means like the end of an old way and the beginning of a new way. When you read the law, when you find the hidden treasure that's really in your life and my life, God really wants to change the way you live. He wants to change the way you think. He wants to change your life, man. And you know, sometimes I think I'm all alone, but sometimes I think that what God really wants to do in our lives, let's not forget what God is doing in our lives, is he's changing us. He's changing us. He's not changing our surroundings. He will change our surroundings to get our attention of what he's really doing in our lives. He's changing us. He's changing our hearts. He's changing our minds. He's changing our souls. You could say it a different way. You could say he's saving your soul. Is Jesus saving anybody's soul? Amen. Now, that's not a one-time thing. That's a lifetime thing. You know that, right? Yes. The salvation of your soul is a lifetime thing, not a one-time thing. He's saving your soul. He's saving you from yourself. He's saving you from your depression and your anger. He's saving you from your sorrow and your bitterness. He's saving you from your separation. He's saving you from you. Can anybody say, thank you, Jesus? Can anybody stop looking at me like that and just say, I'm with you. I'm with you, preacher. Yeah. Can somebody act like they're glad they're here today and happy that I'm talking even though you're not? Yeah. All right. That's what Jesus is doing. He's in the salvation business. What is he doing? He is saving what? Your soul. Amen. That means change. He's constantly changing the way I think. How about you? Yes. Constantly changing how I see things and people and the world itself. How about you? Amen. It's called salvation. Yeah. You see, that's what the building and the rebuilding of the temple is. It's God changing us, constantly changing us. Constantly saving us. Is there a witness in the house? Is there another witness in the house? Amen. Amen. I'll take them both, Pastor Dad. Amen and amen. Yeah. Yeah. You see, they were digging through the rubble, and what they found was the scriptures. You know, it didn't look like this, but in our modern day, let's say we were digging through the house and all of a sudden we found like, oh, we found the scrolls, the words of God that was hidden in the walls. As a matter of fact, in this closet here, there was a stack of about 10 Bibles. Uh-huh. So if you have lost your Bible over the course of the 28 years, know this, you have not lost your Bible. Because I think what God is also showing us is this. When God starts to rebuild your life and my life, usually it starts by a tearing down process. God doesn't really start building. He's got to first tear down, right? He's got to break down some old walls. He's got to break down some old thinking. Sometimes he's got to move some things out of your life or move some people around, right? Anybody? Anybody go through that process, is going through that process now and realize, hey, you know, it's not really the most comfortable process of them all. You know, we like the building, you know? But you see, first he does the process of tearing us down and breaking things down and moving things out. And what he's doing is he's removing the rubble from your life and my life. And I don't know if you guys are holier than me, probably, but I still got some rubble in my life that I need to take out. I think we talked about it last time we talked. You know, sometimes you got to take the trash out, you know. Yeah, I got some stuff, man. You just got to take the trash out. And don't you be looking at my trash. You got your own trash can. I can see you. I can read your minds. It's like, oh, I know what trash he's got. And I'm very happy to take it out. Listen, I'll take out my trash. You take out your trash. Amen. But in the process of God taking out the trash, you know, and removing the rubble and changing things around, you see, he has to move things in your life. And he has to shake things up in your life before you and I discover the hidden treasure that's always been there. And all of a sudden, as God is shaking and shifting and all kinds of heaven and hell are going on in your life, all of a sudden something that is unearthed or discovered is a treasure that has never been outside of you, but a treasure that has always been inside of you, the real treasure. And it's the Word of God. It's the Word of God. It's not like holy writ. It's the Word of God. It's the words of God that's written upon your heart that tells you about Him and about you and about life and about all of the good things of why we were all created. It's written upon your hearts about why this life is a good life and why He has chosen you and blessed you and called you by name. We get distracted with the outward circumstances. We think God wants to, you know, put purple on this wall and tan on this wall, and we'll fight about it for the next 2 years. When God says, who cares? Paint it pink. I don't care. So it will be pink. And you see, just to show you that God, in His sovereignty, is doing something inside of you that's so much more important than what's going on outside of you. And every time you come to this church and you put a piece of paper up, or you sweep a little piece of dust up, or you put a nail in the wall, know this, you are being involved in the process of what God is doing in your life, of the reconditioning and the changing and the good things that He's doing in your life, but inside of mankind. Amen? Amen. So you come and you do what you can do, but realize that's not the most important thing. And through the process of it all, there's going to be something unearthed inside of us, and we're going to find there's always been a very beautiful God inside every one of us, and we just got distracted by the circumstances and the outward conditions of life, and we forget about what life really is about, the invisible realm, the God inside, and the treasure that is inside every one of you. And sometimes we think we don't have any treasure. Sometimes we think, you know, the treasure was taken out of the house a while ago. Any of you ever think that? Any of you dare to raise your hand? Not me, not one of you guys. Some of you think that when God tore down the walls. Some of you think when God took certain things out of your life and changed some things around. Some of you think He took the treasure with it and you don't have any treasure left, and you're waiting for Him to bring the treasure back again. When the Lord wants to tell you, no, I never took the treasure out. I never took the treasure out of your life. The treasure's always been in your life. And he goes through the rubble, and there's this great discovery as we're counting the dollars and what we think is treasure, which isn't. He says, there's the treasure. It's your heart. It's your love for God. It's your hope. It's your faith. There's the treasure. It's your endurance. It's your patience. Anybody in the house with that stuff? It's your long suffering. Right? No, you didn't lose your treasure. You haven't even unearthed your treasure. You thought the treasure went out with the walls and you got nothing good left. And you haven't even discovered, man, you have not even discovered or touched the good, powerful, glorious things that are in your life. And that's why God says, let's tear down the walls. Let me show you what's behind them. Let's show you who you really are. Amen, church? Yeah, right. This is the hidden treasure. As God is doing the work in this house, God is doing the work in your house, Steve. He's doing the work in your house. God bless you. You blessed me by coming today, Steve. I'm glad you're here, brother. You are our brother. We're glad you're here. And, you know, even as I go through the word of the Lord and I come to Hebrews 10, if you have your Bibles, why don't you turn there with me to Hebrews 10. Let me read a few more verses from the scriptures here. I want to read quite a few of them and talk about it just for a minute, okay? So in Hebrews 10, the first verse, it says the law. We're talking about the law. And back in that day, Josiah, they found the law of Moses, perhaps written by his hand itself. But now in this new covenant, this new thing that God is doing, He's addressing the old things that were in your life that you thought were everything. And He says, not really. He says, the law is only a shadow. It was only a shadow of the good things that are coming. Anybody in the house? Anybody say some good things are coming? You want to say that? Some good things are coming. Okay, me and nobody else. Some good things are coming. One more time. Some good things are coming. I don't believe you. Some good things are coming. Now, I got to say this by myself, or for myself, rather. If you want to say it for yourself, now's the time. You ready? Some good things are coming. Okay, that's how I talk to Jesus. I don't know about you. It's like, okay, Jesus, like I'm trying to believe him. Okay, some good things are coming. He says, those things that were torn down or that you lived before, it's not that they were bad. It's just that they were a shadow. They were a shadow of some good things that are coming. And it says, not the reality themselves. For this reason, it can never, by the same sacrifice, repeat endlessly, year after year, perfect those who draw near to worship God. God is talking about the whole religious system that changed in their lives. God changed their lives entirely. God changed the Israelites' religious system. That's everything. Change their religious system. If someone were to come into your life and say, I'm going to change your religious system, you would say, not my religious system. You can go to hell, but I'm keeping my religious system and going to heaven. Right? No. No, you get, because you would say, I'm not changing my religious system. I built this thing for 30, 40, 50 years. I think I kind of tweaked it just right. And God says, yeah? Oh, yeah? That's what he says. He talks like that sometimes. He says, I'm going to tear it all down. Anyway, it says, if it could, those old things and old ways that you did things, if it could, they would have stopped being offered, for the worshipers would have been cleansed once and for all and would no longer have felt guilty of their sins. If we are doing things right, you should no longer feel guilty of your sins. If anyone in this house still feels guilt, we have to change some of our religious systems. Will anybody please say amen with me? Amen. And not because you feel sorry for me, because you live it, okay? If you guys are still feeling guilty in any way, shape, or form, you need to change your religious system. Because God came to take away, I got one amen. Because God came to take away your guilt, your shame, your condemnation. Not to give it to you. Sometimes we think that we're the givers of guilt and shame and condemnation. No. Somebody has to change their religious system. And it goes on, it says, it goes on about the sacrifices. But I want to read in verse 5. Verse 5 says this. It says, therefore, when Christ came into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me. For the burnt offerings and sin offerings, you were not pleased. Then I said, Jesus said, here I am. It is written about me in the scroll. I have come to do your will, O God. When Jesus Christ came to the earth, Scripture says, and the people experience, Jesus fulfilled the entire laws that were written. It says he fulfilled every jot and every tittle. That means, you know, every little comma, every little period and dot above the I's, he fulfilled the law entirely. How on earth did Jesus fulfill the law entirely? This is what I ask sometimes. Sometimes you might ask, how do I follow the precepts and the ways of God? I have to study it and know it and read it and memorize it. Well, maybe, maybe not. Because that's not what Jesus did. Jesus didn't study and read it and memorize it and say, okay, today I'm doing this. Today I'm healing the blind man. Tomorrow I'm going to heal this guy. I'm going to shun. How did Jesus know what to do every moment of every day? Because it says he fulfilled, his life was a fulfillment of the words of God. Does anybody know that? Does anybody, by a raise of hands, know that? He fulfilled all of Scripture. He was the fulfillment of all Scripture, of all righteousness, of all prophecy. How did he do that? How did he do that? How did he fulfill all of the law? I know I asked that a couple times. I'm going to keep on asking it until we come with the answers. You see, did he study it? Did he read it day and night? Not that there's nothing wrong with that, because he did read it and study it. But no, that's not what he did. The reason why Jesus Christ was able to fulfill the law completely, it was a biography. The book was all about him. As a matter of fact, he or God himself wrote a biography about Jesus before he was born. Now, we as human beings can only write them after we're born. You know, you can only write a biography or an autobiography after you've lived your life. You know, as a human being, you can't write it before you lived your life. But God can write a biography before you live your life. Because he is the, you know, he's everything, right? The beginning, the ending, the, you know. So Jesus Christ, when he came to the earth and he lived his life, all he was doing was living his life. The book was just a biography about who he was. So it's not as if Jesus read the book and lived it. It's the opposite. Jesus lived his life, and there was a scribe behind him writing down everything that he did, writing down everything. And then when he was done living his life, they wrapped it up and handed it out. Here, this is the Bible. This is the scrolls. It was a biography. And the way that plays into play with what we're talking about with Josiah and the hidden treasures and what's inside of your heart, sometimes you and I wonder, well, how am I supposed to live my life? How am I supposed to please God? How am I supposed to know his will and live his will? And we'll take our Bibles and read it and read it and read it and read it and read it. But that's not how you do it. That's a biography. It's already written upon your hearts. And if we are the body of Christ, these books have already been written. It's a biography of your life, of how you're going to live your life. You don't read that book to find out how you're going to live. You live your life and realize the book's already been written about your life. Amen. Jesus Christ was the embodiment of Scripture, the embodiment of vision. You know, when he get up to give a pep talk or an encouraging word, he didn't study to find out what he was going to say. No, he said it from his very essence, and people wrote books and volumes about what he said. He didn't read a book to find out what he was going to say. He said it, and they wrote the books. Amen. He said the world itself could not contain the books from the life that Jesus lived. You don't need to read a book and study to find out God and find your life and find your true essence. All you got to do is remove the rubble out of your life and discover the treasure that's inside of you. And what Scripture says is the Word of God is written upon your heart, man. Your life is already scripted out. It's on your heart. It's written upon your heart. And maybe to help, you know, us relate to these things that I believe God is saying to us is, you know, we're celebrating our church anniversary, New Image Ministries. We're celebrating 28 years. And as we come together tonight at 4 o'clock, we'll speak what we've always spoken for the last 28 years. We'll come together and we'll talk about the vision, right? Because you got to talk about the vision. What's the vision? No problem. We'll talk about the vision. What's your goals, man? What's your plans? What is the vision? Who is New Image Ministries Church? How do we discover the vision of New Image Ministries? Do we read a book? Do we study? No. Because we are New Image Ministries. Amen. There's no book to read to discover who we are. We have to write the books ourselves. So we will come up. We don't need to study for our meeting about vision. All we have to do is declare what's in our hearts, and then you can write the books when we're done talking. Because we are the vision. Because we are New Image Ministries. The books have not been written yet because you haven't lived it yet. The most important, most valuable resource upon the planet is not a book. It is you. It is your life. It is the words that are in your heart and in your mouth. That is the most powerful things. And when you're all done living your life, then we'll write the books. Yeah, because the treasure of the temple resides inside of you. Resides inside of you. Anybody in the house today? Anybody in the house, man? You want to discover who God is? You want to discover what your life is all about? It's already written on your heart. You need vision, you need plan, you need purpose. Stop going to the bookstores just for a while. You can go back later, but stop going to the bookstores for a while. And why don't you discover the true treasure that's written upon your heart and let someone come behind you? Because God sent forth the scribe. Remember, the king sent forth the scribe. He's the guy that wrote everything down. Let there be a scribe that comes behind you, the Holy Spirit himself, that writes down every detail of your life. And there's the scroll. There's the scroll. Amen. It's the life lived. God's not hard to find. He's not hard to find. He's not outside of you. Sometimes we think that all of the knowledge and information and things about God and everything that we want is outside of us, and we're reaching and grabbing, whatever we think those treasures are. We think if it's knowledge, we're in a book. We think it's money, then we're going to grab some money somewhere. Whatever you think is treasure and you're outside grabbing for it, God wants to knock down some walls, man. He wants to remove some rubble out of your life. He wants to unearth the real treasures of God and say it's in your heart. It's inside of you, man. You want to know who your God is? You want the life of God released inside of your life, in this planet, in the earth itself? All we got to do is remove the rubble. You ain't got to read no book. All you got to do is remove the rubble and live your life. And watch out, man. Watch out. Amen. I want a whole litany of scribes behind me. You ready? Let's go. You start writing. And all they're going to do is write what's already written upon your heart. Amen. Amen. God ain't hard. There's a treasure inside of every one of you that God is unearthing. He's going to tear down our walls. He's going to remove some things. He's going to cause the dust to kick up a little bit. And you're going to discover some real treasure. You're going to discover that God has already written upon your heart the plan and the purpose for your life. You listen to your heart. You know, in this passage here, you know, it talks about that there's three people that this passage does talk about. It talks about the king, talks about the scribe, and it talks about the high priest. the king, Josiah, remember him, sent forth the scribe. Does anybody remember his name? Shapheth. He sent them to the high priest. Does anybody remember his name? Hilkiah. King sent forth the scribe to go ask Hilkiah, is there any good stuff in the temple? What do you got in the temple? What's in the temple? The father himself, which is the king, will send forth the scribe, which is the Holy Spirit, to the high priest, which is Jesus Christ in your life. God will send forth his spirit into your life and ask the God inside of you, you got any treasures inside of you? You have any treasures for me today? And God himself, all by himself, will start to release and unearth and show to you the treasures that are already here. See, God is going to work in your life, and he's going to start to show you. He's going to, you say, is there any treasures in my life? And he's going to start to unearth the treasures that are in your life. And then when you find those treasures, Scripture says this. What are you supposed to do with those treasures? Shout them out to the world, man. Man, don't keep those treasures to yourself. Shout them out to the world. You need to live your life, and you need to live it large. And you need to fulfill the things that are written upon your heart. Your life is not written in any book. It's written upon your heart. Nobody knows but God himself, and he's written it upon your heart, where you're going and what you're going to do. And it's powerful, and it's beautiful, and you have to believe it and trust in it. Because when you don't trust your heart, when you don't trust the words of God, you still hear everybody? When you don't trust the words of God that's written upon your heart, man, you start to worship some idols. You worship things outside of you. You start to read a book and say, I think we should do that. You start to listen to this clown over here and think you should do that. You start to grab riches outside of you saying, this is life and this is valuable. And you start to have some idolatry in your life, and you're worshiping things that are all around you because you don't trust God. Because you don't trust God. What do you mean I don't trust God? God is written upon your heart. What's he telling you? What did he tell you this morning? What is your heart telling you, man? Does anybody trust God? Does anybody trust God? I know we all say we do. I trust God. Does anybody raise your hands at me? Does anybody trust God? Amen. Well, then what's he telling you? What is on your heart? What do you want to do? What is God speaking to you? Do you trust that? I'm going to ask you again. Do you trust God? Because he's on the inside of you. He's the treasure inside of you. You know, we can trust this and we can read this. It's outside of us. We can trust a man preaching to us. It's outside of us. And sometimes we're looking outside of us for the treasures. Man, nobody knows what's written upon your heart but you and God, man. The treasure is written upon your heart. And I do believe that it has yet to be unearthed. I believe this. I believe that there's a you inside of you that is so powerful, that is so big, that is so large, that is so happy. Anyone believe that one? There's a you inside of you that's very happy, but they're buried under the rubble. Sometimes you take a peek on a Sunday, and maybe on a Wednesday. There is a you inside of you that has not been unearthed. You're not going to find it anywhere but inside of you. Do you trust God? He will speak to your heart. And Scripture tells you, I can give you 1,000 scriptures if you want something outside of you to speak to you, that tell you the Word of God is written upon your heart. The Word of God, it is near you. It is in your mouth. Nothing on that one. It is in your mouth. Amen. I got one amen. Yeah. Phil, I believe this. I believe there's us inside of us that's so powerful and big, and we get caught up with all the externals that we don't live this largeness that's inside of us. And God said, no, this earth has not yet seen the treasures that I put inside of my temple. We thought the treasures left the temple. Everyone in the house? Amen. Yeah, that was good. I didn't expect that. The treasures inside of you, amen? Amen. Treasures inside of you. Let me ask the praise and worship team to come forward. And as they do, why don't you all stand with them? And I'd like to do that song, Oceans, again. And listen, this song, Oceans, everybody here, or did I lose you already? It's a few minutes long. Why don't you spend some time with God? Why don't you close your eyes? Why don't you look up to the heavens? Why don't you talk to the Lord, or let the Lord talk to you, rather, and open up these ears? Is that all right? Praise the Lord. Let us worship our God.
You know, the restoration of the temple is the healing process, right? That's what my brother just talked about. And I believe as we're healing his house, he is healing our house. Amen. I find it interesting he used an 8-year-old boy to basically heal that nation, to restore that nation. And of course, it does take childlike faith. It's the only way you're going to get into the kingdom. He said, you need childlike faith. You need an 8-year-old boy to just come in and say, man, there's something greater. And just like that, and Josiah's name means heals, by the way. That's what his name means, heals. And it also says that in the end of that passage that my brother was reading, it says that as a king, he had a tender heart. You want to heal? It's real simple. You just need a tender heart. I mean, what else would an 8-year-old boy know to do other than be tender? He doesn't know anything else yet. He hasn't seen or, you know, been jaded and this and that. All he knows to do is just to be tender. That's what an 8-year-old does. You want to heal? You just got to be tender-hearted. That's the healing. God comes in, he says, man, that child that's inside of you. It's just a simplicity to God. It's like my brother was just saying, he's not hard, it's just simplicity. That's simplicity. Just to be tender-hearted, you'll heal a nation. 8-year-old boy, heal the nation, amen? Let's go before the Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord God. We thank you for what... For all that you are doing here, Lord God, and that there is a restoration, Lord God. There's a restoration of your house physically then, Lord, but there's also one spiritually, Lord God. And we thank you for the Josiah that's inside of each and every one of us, Lord God, that says, thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for this treasure. And I pray, Lord, we'll be like little children and we just want to go out and share the treasure, Lord, with the world. Because we realize that our King has given us this precious gift, Lord God. And through this, Lord God, we'll go out and we'll heal the nation, Lord God. And we'll touch others, Lord God. And we'll restore the kingdom, Lord God. Because it's by childlike faith, Lord. It's our ability to be tenderhearted and to be loving and to be kind, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for this day, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, for the glory that's all around, Lord God. We thank you for this temple, Lord God, that you've entrusted to us, Lord. He said, it's in your hands. Go do it. We thank you for it this day, Lord God. We will rebuild it for your honor and for your glory, Lord God, and for the declaration of your love. We thank you for it this day, Lord God. And everybody said, amen. Amen.